So the next thing to talk about is energy changes and intermolecular attractions and how this all comes together for phase changes. And we're going to look at this in terms of the phase diagram. When we talk about intermolecular attractions, enthalpy changes are based on how tightly the molecules are hanging on to each other. When we're going from a solid to a liquid for fusion, it takes a certain amount of energy, and the intermolecular attractions are pretty important there because we're going from the solid, where they're packed in really tightly, to the liquid, where they're moving around touching each other. So the change in intermolecular distance isn't that great. But if the molecules really want to hold on to each other in the solid, because you have strong intermolecular forces, it will take more energy to melt it than it will if the molecules are not that attracted to each other. And that kind of makes sense, right? Because you have to break those interactions. So the enthalpy of vaporization, where we're going from the liquid to the gas, is going to always be bigger for the same material than the enthalpy of the fusion. And the enthalpy of sublimation will be bigger than its enthalpy of vaporization. And regardless of which enthalpy we're talking about, if we have high intermolecular attractions, we will have a higher enthalpy, whether it's fusion or vaporization or sublimation. Now, we've alluded to equilibrium a couple times before, where we said we can have a system in equilibrium where it's evaporating and condensing in a sealed container at the same rate. And when we do this, we talk about it with equilibrium as a double-headed arrow. In the notes, you'll see that I've typed it like this because I didn't have this feature that I could find in any font. So it means the reaction is proceeding in both directions at the same rate. So let's look at this example. Suppose we have a liquid in equilibrium with the vapor. Liquid plus heat makes vapor. So vapor can cool down and make heat plus a liquid. When we talk about equilibria, we talk about shifting the equilibrium. If I add more heat to water, what happens? I get more vapor, right? If I take away heat, I get more liquid. So we can think about this idea with equilibrium, and we can talk about the position of the equilibrium. The position can be reactant favored, where I have more reactant, or it can be product favored, where I have more product. We talk a lot more about equilibrium in chapter 12, and you're not going to have any questions about what is equilibrium or how is this going to shift. The questions are just going to have the word equilibrium in there as a vocabulary word in the problem, and you should just know that we're talking about going back and forth, okay? You're not going to be predicting equilibrium. You're just going to say, at equilibrium, this happens. So think about this now and how the temperature affects the vapor pressure of a solid. If I have a solid plus heat is in equilibrium with vapor, what happens if I crank up the temperature? I'll get more vapor, right? So at a higher temperature, I get more vapor. And if I get more vapor, what does that do to the vapor pressure? Makes it higher. So I get a higher vapor pressure. And remember, if I have higher intermolecular forces, what kind of vapor pressure do I get? Higher or lower? Lower. Because the more the molecules are hanging on to each other, the less vapor you make, right? So we take all these definitions and discussions, and we combine them into a phase diagram. So the goal for this is that you are going to be able to look at a phase diagram, read the phase diagram, and answer some questions. You will not be required to draw one. And typically, you'll see this in the multiple choice format. So if we flip to the next page, two pages, oh dear. Do you not have a phase diagram in your packet?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is. Okay. I don't know why I didn't have one here. Got a little nervous. Okay, here's the phase diagram. So this is a phase diagram for water, and it is different than the phase diagram for a lot of other things. And it's because water is weird because of the hydrogen bonding. So when you look at this phase diagram, the first thing you'll notice is that it's a graphical representation of pressure and temperature combinations. So we can look at this and say, well, at this pressure and this temperature, I can look at this and say, okay, I have a solid. In this area, I have a liquid. In this area, I have a gas. Now, this diagram is labeled for you. On the test, these areas will not be labeled. It's your job to know that this is solid, liquid, and gas. And if you just stop and think a minute, you say, well, if I'm at low temperatures, I tend to get a solid, right? And here I'm at higher pressure where I'm squeezing them together, I have a solid. If it's really low pressure and a low temperature, I have a gas. And in between, I have a liquid. So I think it's pretty easy to remember. Solid goes to liquid, goes to gas. And you can identify that because it won't be identified for you on the test. So now, if we look at this, here if we look in the solid area, we have this line from A to B. And that is the equilibrium line between solid and gas. So if I'm sitting on this line, I have solid and gas in a sublimation equilibrium. If I'm sitting on this line from solid to liquid, right here from B to C, I'm on the melting freezing line. On this line, liquid to gas, I'm on the evaporation condensation line. Now, when you look at these lines, you say, okay, that kind of makes sense. Another area here, if you look at this line, 760, this is 760 torr of pressure, or one atmosphere pressure. If I were to ask you, what temperature does water boil at? What would you tell me? Let me ask you, what temperature does water boil? 100 degrees Celsius. Most people just say 100 degrees Celsius. They don't specify 760, right? Because 100 Celsius or 212 Fahrenheit, we call that the normal boiling point of water, and it's normal because that is the boiling point at one atmosphere pressure. So the 760 line is called the normal line, and that is an important vocabulary word. So if it says the normal boiling point, it means the pressure is 760. That's called the triple point. Okay? We didn't get there yet. But I wanted to point that out. Okay? So the triple point is right here. And interesting about this is that most substances have been documented to have a triple point. Helium has never been found to have a triple point that could be measured where solid, liquid, and vapor are all in equilibrium. I think that's kind of interesting about helium gas. Okay? Why do you think that there's a helium shortage then? Have you heard about that, the helium shortage we've been having for a couple of years? Okay, you're all going in science careers. Did you know they use helium for cooling magnets for things like MRI machines? You did know that. Yeah, you knew that because your mom works with helium and has that. So it's been a big deal that there's been kind of a helium shortage. And part of the properties of helium and not having a triple point is what makes it so valuable for cooling down these big magnets. So that's kind of some useless trivia as far as this class is concerned. But I think it's important to know what's going on in the world in science. So this is the triple point. And another interesting point up here is D. This is called the critical point. And the critical point is interesting because once you get up here, you see how this line starts to get dotted? There is no longer a distinction between the liquid and the gas. You cannot tell this is properties of a liquid, this is properties of a gas, because it is indistinct, and it's called a supercritical fluid. And the properties of that material are somewhere in between. I think there's really interesting science in that that has become everyday technology. Most of you are younger in here, and you're college students, so you like to drink coffee to stay awake, right? Some of you don't. I don't either. I take my caffeine cold and carbonated, right? You see the Diet Coke up here. So people drink a lot of coffee because of the caffeine in there. And then as you get older, they tell people, stop drinking all that coffee with the caffeine. So quite a few years back, they invented decaffeinated coffee. The first decaf coffee was Sanka. It was nasty, according to my dad, because I don't drink coffee. But that's what my mom made him drink, because that was before drip coffee and Keurigs, and you had to boil the coffee on the stove to make coffee. So he had instant coffee, and sometimes they would boil the decaffeinated beans and make coffee. And everybody complained about decaf coffee because they said it tasted bad. Well, the reason it tasted bad, which I guess it did, I never ate any, was because to get the caffeine out of the beans, they would soak them in methylene chloride. Now, most of you don't know what methylene chloride is, but have you ever taken clothes to the dry cleaners? Do you know that smell that your clothes have when they come back from the dry cleaners? Okay, that's a halogenated hydrocarbon, very similar to methylene chloride. So think of that dry cleaning smell slash taste in your coffee. Nasty, right? And so they would use the methylene chloride to extract the caffeine and then make the coffee, and it was residual and it was nasty. So they did this for about 20 years, and then they found out that methylene chloride, oh, by the way, it was a carcinogen. So you're taking middle-aged, overweight people with health problems, telling them not to drink coffee, and you now start feeding them a carcinogen, right? It raised a few issues for public health. So in the industry, they switched to a different way to make decaf coffee, and I think this is really interesting. They use supercritical carbon dioxide. Take carbon dioxide, crank up the temperature and the pressure so you get this supercritical fluid, and it kind of oozes around the coffee beans. It extracts the caffeine. Then all they have to do is reduce the pressure. Goes into the gas phase, the CO2 goes off, they can recycle it, and here is your coffee separated from the caffeine. There's no chemical contaminants because the CO2 is gone. They can now separate the coffee beans, sell them to the people that need decaf coffee, take all that powdered caffeine, sell it to the people that make Jolt and Pepsi and everything else where they're loading the caffeine in. So it's a win-win situation, and nobody's drinking carcinogens in their morning coffee. So that's a supercritical fluid. Yes?
So what will we need to know, just like the certain points?
You will need to recognize all these points, and you will need to be able to read this chart and answer the kinds of questions that we will address when we meet on Thursday.
Okay.
So have half-hour lecture Thursday.